If there is a role for extracorporeal to remove in unintubated patient, well, let me first something that interests me more and more with the years. Why do we ventilate the patient, or why we ventilate? Why? Because to maintain the gas exchange. You use mechanical ventilation, whatever it is for, and we use a spontaneous breathing in a plus or minus some addition, technical addition, to have a decent PO2 and PCO2, right? Now, if I put PO2 and PCO2 in one side, these are a function of what? These are a function of only one variable, which is the ratio between ventilation divide perfusion. I was hearing before Tommaso and Laurent and so on. We didn't have one word as commonly used about the perfusion. I think we should learn, or maybe to think that any time we speak about the ventilation of the lung, also to think how our different mode may interfere and in which way with the perfusion. The mention in perfusion was done with the self-inflicted lung injury, which is an old story. I think it was first described in 1936 by Barak, who prepared a model of rabbits in which the trachea was restricted, and it was generating edema because of the negative pressure generated by this poor rabbit trying to breathe. Now, we have negative pressure ventilation, positive pressure ventilation, the most different mixture. We are always playing within this battlefield. What is the basic difference? That any time that we use as a motor of the ventilation, the muscles, the respiratory muscle, more or less we generate a negative pleural pressure. Heart and big vessels are surrounded by the negative pressure. So we increase the venous return. And if you have athletes after marathons, or horses, we are not in mechanical ventilation, after a big run, they start to have some sign of subtle edema, some hemorrhagia, some capillary ruptures. Of course, everything depends by the extent in which this happen. If we use positive pressure ventilation, we can do whatever we want, but any time we touch a knob of the ventilator, we change the hemodynamics because the pleural pressure tends to become more positive. The kidney immediately respond, and usually we do not care too much because you are so accustomed to have fluids and maybe some cardioactive drug. Well, you give something more and the hemodynamics stay there. But the price we pay may be 1, 2, 3, 4 liters of overweight. And then we discover that maybe the increasing weight is related to the mortality. Wait a second, this is an effect, is a cause, is a mixture of the things. So my only problem is I am more and more convinced after the last 3 years, practically I did only experimental part, but giving for long-term experiments in pigs, long-term means 2 days or 3 nights or 3 nights and today, and I'm more and more convinced that we cannot speak about damage or advantages of the mechanical ventilation without considering the hemodynamic part. Back many decades, spontaneous breathing and extracorporeal support. At the time when I went in the United States, I didn't speak one word in English, now not much more, but my duty was to test the PCO2 and the PO2 across the membrane lung, because Kolobov, who passed away last year, and Kolobov was a genius. That means in advance with our thinking, at least 15, 20 years, the first speaking about the damage of mechanical ventilation and so on. The extracorporeal membrane lung was already a failure, the Zeppel study. So Kolobov say, okay, why we do not remove the CO2 to have the dialysis in a COPD patient? I will touch this at the end of this presentation. And so my duty was to measure the PCO2 exchange, the efficiencies of the membrane lung. But I had a few years, 3-4 years of intensive care and some passion for the physiology. So I wanted to see, I don't remember why, how the sheep respond to the CO2 removal. So we made a closed circuit, measuring the CO2, and after it was easy to show that when we were removing 50% of the CO2 produced metabolically on the metabolism, the sheep in spontaneous breathing will say, why should I breathe to eliminate more CO2 than necessary? It was decreasing his own ventilation to reduce the exhalation of CO2 by 50%. If you were removing 100% of the CO2, the sheep was stopping breathing. But if you give some oxygen in a motionless lung, the PO2 was maintained. Because to oxygenate, we need some oxygen equal to the oxygen consumed. To ventilate, we need to move the lung unless we have an artificial lung. So this slide, I think, was the basis of the concept of the lung rest and a series of further consequences, but there was very clear the physiology at that point. But these were spontaneous breathing animals and normal animals. Many years after, this is my uncle work, Thomas Langer, went to the United States and they did the same experiment, taking a sheep, normal sheep, and inducing in the sheep the ARDS. So they were doing extracorporeal CO2 removal before and after the damages. And this is quite clear. You can see how is the transpulmonary pressures in the changes in pressure during spontaneous in esophageal pressure, during spontaneous breathing in healthy animals, which behave as the sheep in Washington 20 years before. That means I increase 50% of CO2 removal, decrease 50% of CO2 production, but look what happens when you start to put the CO2 in spontaneous breathing animal. That means you may maintain the CO2, but you have a tremendous driving, as Doron said before. The brain does not accept this. I think one of the great mistakes, but philosophical mistake we may do, is to consider that whatever does the brain control is good. I mean, our brain does a lot of stupid things in a normal life. Why should be good in physiology? Also in physiology, it has a lot of mistakes. We are waiting artificial intelligence to counteract the human stupidity, the natural stupidity. But I'm afraid that also the artificial intelligence has some artificial stupidity together. It's unavoidable. Anyway, and this, you can see that extracorporeal CO2 removal, we have a big reduction of the minute ventilation when, which is a function of the CO2 which is eliminated. Moving, everything is moved, you still have some reduction when you have the animal with the RDS, but still the input for the breathing is tremendous. And this where the first series, now we have far more, but basically, I don't want to spend too much time on it, are, let's see, three categories of patients in which we used the CO2 in spontaneous breathing. One are the patients with basically with cystic fibrosis waiting for the lung transplant. So they have a tremendous drive, but in this patient, when you were removing the CO2, they behaved as the normal sheep. So they reduce the frequency, they start to sleep because they stop with this tremendous drive. A possible risk is the hypoxia, because if we do not breathe and we don't have oxygen enough, the alveolar PO2 goes down. But for this patient, the CO2 removal and spontaneous breathing is okay. The patient with asthma or with hyperinflation, I think, is a very good system. I was looking at the non-invasive ventilation and so on. But to me, many of these patients, one of the problems they have, they start hyperinflated. And they know they need to be ventilated. But to ventilate a patient which is already with a lung like this is a little bit complicated, and I was never really convinced that couldn't be a better system. With the CO2 removal, the extracorporeal CO2 removal, everything becomes far smoother. You decrease the PCO2 and they readapt and they deflate slowly. The problem is for how long? Because as Laurent showed, if this patient come with a reassertion of COPD, put the extracorporeal CO2 removal, perfect. Okay, thank you doctor, see you later, go home, and after 3 weeks, come back. What we are doing? Or come back after, again, after 2-3 months. So this open a scenario which is quite impressive. Of course, when the basic, I already told you, any time you remove the CO2 extracorporeally, you decrease in part the need of ventilation. More or less, depends by the drive, and the drive is always very high. So, if I have to summarize spontaneous breathing and transplant, good. Rehabilitation of COPD with all the limits works. Severe RDS. Severe RDS, spontaneous breathing, I think, is not a good idea. Because everybody knows now that in severe RDS, what is the problem? It's not the, because the first approach could be, okay, I have the ventilator-induced lung injury. I take the ventilator. I Oppure vuoi il ventilator? The ventilator induced lung injury disappear. Unfortunately, it's not the ventilator, it's the ventilation induced lung injury. Independently, by if the energy is paid by the electricity or is paid by the muscle, the respiratory muscle. If I apply the same energy to move, the effect on the lung, on hemodynamics, in hemodynamics are different, but the effect on the lung are the same. The effects in hemodynamics, in spontaneous breathing, in this condition may be devastating, because it's very easy, because you have a tremendous difference in inflow. And this is another problem, how to judge the lung lesions, also experimentally, because you speak about the edema. But if you have a tremendous PEEP and very high pressure, or put at the limit the reasoning, if you stop flow, you don't have any edema. To have edema, you need flow. And you may have a disaster in the lung, but no edema. You may have a fracture of the extracellular matrix. We have a histological fractures, but you don't see edema. In the classical volo trauma, the edema is far less than in so-called focused trauma, as the atelec trauma. So, new era, well, start not many years ago, the partial CO2 removal. I think we did this in 86, and it was quite funny to see the patients, but they were more or less during weaning, special circumstances and so on. Patient maybe, if I would be in America, in US, I would put a slide with the patient watching the television, say, hello, 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 or the movie of the nurse is happy and so on. But, you know, a patient in very good conditions with some CO2 remover, or patient, example, with bronchopleural fistula. You know, sometimes you have this tremendous fistula, you do not really know how to handle, because any times you ventilate, you maintain the leakage. The extracorporeal CO2 remover, you may invent a lot of situation in which is appropriate the control of the ventilation. And the last I want to teach and I want to discuss very briefly with you is back to Kolobov, to the regular dialysis. And you say, oh, the regular dialysis is not the real sense, because as soon as I stop to remove the CO2, the PCO2 goes up again. And you know that if you start to hyperventilate, the PCO2 in 5 minutes go down. If you hypoventilate, in 15 minutes goes up. There are interesting papers about that. But I'm not aware of many, personally I didn't find any, in which this was associated with the measurement of the VCO2. How much is the total amount? Because if you read the literature, you say, okay, very easy, the respiratory quotient is 0.8 as average. If I measure the oxygen consumption, I can multiply the oxygen consumption by 0.8, I get the VCO2. Are you sure? Well, let's see, when we did a series of experiments to induce damage in the lung, in pigs, we use a very high ventilation. And we were measuring VO2 with a FIC and VCO2 through the usual way, you know, measuring the expired CO2 times the rate of ventilation or total ventilation, and so on. And we consistently found that even after 48 hours, the respiratory quotient was 1.2, 1.3, extremely higher not 0.85, 1.1, but extremely higher than the VO2. So we said, well, okay, maybe we measure something wrong. So we recently redid these experiments measuring the VO2 in absolute perfect way, which is through the closed system, through the gases, and measuring the VCO2 in 3-4 modes, and oxygen consumption in 3-4 modes. There is no way when you decrease the CO2, you go down, but you exhale far, far less CO2 than normal. And when you increase the PaCO2, so you hypoventilate, you exhale less CO2. Where the CO2 goes? Everybody knows in the book there are the CO2 reserve. Biocarbonate, okay, but the CO2 reserve, how much they are? You have 5 liters, you make a computation, so you have the late reserve, which are bone, fat, and so on, which are quite impressive. So we are having some astonishing results. Just in the last minute, in the 50s, they put in the submarine about 40 marines for 40 days inhaling 1% of CO2, just to control, because wasn't the problem the CO2 control. When they were taken out, they exhale for 30 days for more CO2. And try to think a possible scenario. Imagine that the CO2 level is the water level in a bath when you take a bath, okay? If I have 20, all the CO2, 20 or 40 or 60 is the total level. Let's imagine that I have a COPD patient, not in recruitization, which cannot move because whatever effort, oxygen is enough, but cannot exhale CO2 because it's full. Try to imagine that we decrease the CO2 reserve for 3-4 days and then back for a little bit more active, so on. So I think there is a possible basis, the CO2 removal in this way, for open and a different physiological approach to the COPD patient. As Kolobov imagined about 40 years ago. Thank you for the attention.
Thanks so much, Luciano, for this beautiful physiological talk. I'm afraid that we have to move on because we run out of...
Yes, no, I'm sorry, but I was looking, 19 was the number of the slide, not the minute.
No.
So, sorry.
No problem. So thanks again, Luciano, and we move on to the next speaker.